Hi everyone, it's the Math Sorcerer here with Chegg. In this video, we're going to be discussing rational expressions. Let's do an example. Find the domain of the rational expression. In part A, we have 3 over 7 minus x. Let's work it out. Solution. So the domain of the rational expression is the set of all x's that we can plug into the expression that makes sense. If you look at this, the only value of x we can't plug in is 7. Because if I were to put a 7 where the x is, then you get 3 over 7 minus 7. That's 3 over 0. And you can't have 0 on the bottom. The domain is all of the x's except 7. So you could just write that, all the x's except 7. I'm going to write it in set notation. So it's the set of all x such that x is not equal to 7. And so that's going to be domain of our rational expression. Again, it's read the set of all x such that x is not equal to 7. Let's do another one. Part B, we have the square root of x minus 4. Solution. So again, we're looking for the set of all x's that we can plug into the expression that makes sense. In this case, we have a square root, so you can't take the square root of a negative number. So whatever's inside the square root, in this case that's x minus 4, has to be greater than or equal to 0. Whenever you have a square root and you're looking for the domain, just take whatever's inside the square root and set it greater than or equal to 0. Then we can add 4 to both sides, so plus 4 plus 4. And so we get x greater than or equal to 4. So it's the set of all x such that x is greater than or equal to 4. You can write that in words. I'm going to do better. I'm going to write it in set notation. This is the set, all x such that x is greater than or equal to 4. So this would be the domain of this rational expression. Again, in the first example, we had an issue because we were dividing by 0, which is a very common issue, so that's something to look for. And in this example, we had an issue because we had a square root. And whenever you have a square root, you take whatever's inside your square root and set it greater than or equal to 0. These are the two most common examples when finding domain. All right, let's go ahead and do something a little bit different. In this next example, we're going to be simplifying. So part A, we have 2xy over x plus xy. Let's work it out, solution. You'll notice maybe that on the bottom, you have a common factor of x. Let's rewrite this and factor out that common factor. So this is 2xy divided by, and then on the bottom we have x plus xy. So this is equal to 2xy divided by, so now let's pull out that x. I'm going to write the x and then write a parenthesis. And then you ask yourself, what do you multiply by x in order to get x? Well, just 1. And then plus. And then what do you multiply by x in order to get xy? Well, y. And here's where the magic happens. The x's cancel. And so we end up with 2y over 1 plus y. And so this would be the simplified version of our expression. Let's go ahead and do another one. Part B, we have x squared minus 4 all divided by 2 minus x. Let's go ahead and work this one out. Solution. So right away you can see that in the numerator you have the difference of squares. So recall, if you have a squared minus b squared, that's equal to a minus b times a plus b. In this particular example, we have x squared minus 4, which is 2 squared. That would be x minus 2, x plus 2. So in this case, I'm going to write the numerator as x minus 2 times x plus 2. And in the denominator, we still have 2 minus x. So it would be really nice if the denominator was x minus 2. So what we're going to do is we're going to make that happen. Watch this. This is x minus 2, x plus 2, and then I'm going to factor out a negative 1 from the denominator. This is a reoccurring idea. So watch this. Negative 1 times parentheses. Negative 1 times what is going to give me a negative x? Well, just x. Then negative 1 times what is going to give me a 2? Well, minus 2. And you can check, negative 1 times x is negative x, negative 1 times negative 2 is positive 2. So it basically reverses what you have. 2 minus x becomes x minus 2, and you put a negative. And look at this. Here's the magic. Magic. This is x plus 2 over negative 1, which is really negative 1 times x plus 2, because you can bring it upstairs, or you can put it in the front, and then distribute. So you get negative x minus 2. Very nice. This is a key example that comes up a lot, so worth knowing this little trick. So really nice. Let's do something different. In our last example, we are going to do some addition. Let's go ahead and work through it. Solution. We'll start by writing it down again. So we have 2 over x plus 1 and plus 1 over x plus 3. And I left some room here on purpose because what we're going to do is we're going to multiply this by something. In order to add these fractions, we have to have the same denominator. And so one way to do this is to basically use the common denominator equal to the product. This is called the least common denominator in this case. And so you just look at each fraction and you ask yourself, what's missing? So what's missing here in order to get x plus 1, x plus 3? Well, you're missing x plus 3. So you multiply by x plus 3 over x plus 3. Then you come over here and you say, what's missing here? Well, you're missing an x plus 1. So you multiply by x plus 1 over x plus 1. Note, essentially, you're multiplying by 1. That's why this is okay to do, because these cancel. So this is the same thing as 2 times x plus 3 over x plus 1, x plus 3, plus, and then 1 times x plus 1 is just x plus 1, over x plus 3, x plus 1. The denominators are basically the same. They're just written in, you know, reverse order. That's no big deal. So now we can write it under a common denominator. So x plus 1, x plus 3. And then we can add here 2x, or multiply rather, and then 6. Right? Because it's 2 times x is 2x, 2 times 3 is 6. Then we have x, and then we have the 1. This is equal to 2x plus x, which is 3x, plus 1 plus 6, which is 7. That's all over x plus 1, and then x plus 3. Super nice. So just as a recap, when you first see a problem like this, the idea is you want to find a common denominator. So one way to do that is to take these and multiply them. And then you just take each fraction and you multiply by what's missing. So here we have an x plus 1. We're missing an x plus 3 in order to get our common denominator. So you multiply by 1 in a clever way. Over here we have x plus 3, but you're missing the x plus 1. So you multiply by the common denominator in order to get that. And then you just basically combine everything and add across and finish up. Hopefully you've learned some math in this video. And if you did, make sure to check out more videos on Chegg. Until next time, good luck and take care.